My name is David Krause. I'm the Associate Provost here at Dominican, and like everybody else, I want to thank you for being here with us the last couple of days. Thank Janice for what she's done. And I wasn't planning on this, but I have the unexpected pleasure of introducing my former colleague and my still friend, Stephanie Shonekan. Stephanie and I were colleagues at Columbia College Chicago, and now, as you know from the program, Stephanie is in Columbia at the University of Missouri. And I have seen similar presentations in the past, and I know we're in for a stimulating multimedia extravaganza. So Stephanie, thank you for being here.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you for being here. It's such a lovely afternoon, and I know it's tempting to sit outside in the sun, and so I really am thrilled that you took the time to come in and hear what I had to say about these two Americas that I'm so intrigued by. So I'm just going to go ahead and start, and I call this presentation Ebony and Ivory, and it's a musical journey to two Americas. So as you guys can remember, Ebony and Ivory is a 1982 song that came out on Paul McCartney's album, Tug of War, and in this song he collaborated with Stevie Wonder. So how many of you remember that song? We all know that song, right? It was number one for several weeks on the Billboard Hot 100 list, and we heard it many, many times, and we know what the sentiments are behind that song. So when you look at the reviews of the song, though, and this is something I'd always thought about, especially when I first moved to the United States and discovered I was black, because I didn't know I was black until I moved here. It made me think, well, that song that Stevie Wonder and Paul McCartney sang, you know, where they said, you know, we're all the same, you know, we live together in perfect harmony, you know, those ideas are ideas that don't seem to exist in the United States that I came to meet. So looking at some of the reviews that came out in some of the more serious periodical. This one says, intended as an anthem to further the cause of racial justice. I'm going to try this. Intended as an anthem to further the cause of racial justice and understanding, the song instead plays like a stoned person's detached musings, stretching the central metaphor beyond the brink, as it offers pat reassurance in the place of an actual call to action. Another one, which is similarly interesting, says, in a time when both singers' home nations continue to do business with institutionally racist South Africa, Ebony and Ivory grinned and winked and stuck a thumb in the air. Everyone's the same, they enthused. Ebony and Ivory living in perfect harmony. You know, and so this is a sort of a tongue-in-cheek. But going through those lyrics again, I was thinking about it, and it says in the first verse, we all know that people are the same wherever they go. There's good and bad in everyone, and so on and so on and so forth. But then they also say we learn to live, we learn to give, right? So we learn to live, which is maybe the most true statement in those lyrics, is a fact that I try to tell my students all the time, that culture is about living, it's about learning other people's ways of life. You're not born with culture. And so I want to take that sentiment, learning, the idea that culture is learned, and use that as we go along on this journey, and then think about how people learn. They learn their identity, how to construct that. They learn religion, political ideology, and philosophy. And then the next question is that if people do learn and they live in their own regions and their own territories, then they're learning very different things. So by now, you have heard my voice for a few minutes, and you're wondering that since I'm obviously not from around these parts, right? You're wondering what I could possibly tell you about your American culture. It's the same thing that I might wonder about what a Scottish explorer like David Livingstone would tell me about the topography of some parts of Africa, or the Swedish Bernt Linsport might tell us about West African literature, or the British political scientist Martin Meredith might tell me about the political state of Africa, or even Bono from Ireland would tell us about African debt, right? So sometimes these kinds of outsiders can bring an objective view, maybe some clarity and some depth to the reading of a space, especially one that is, to an observer's eye, wrought with gaping divisions and fierce allegiances. And trust me, I've lived and I've grown up in a space where there were these kinds of divisions between ethnic groups. Never mind the lovely Star Spangled Banner, that's lovely, I know. We had a national anthem in Nigeria just before the Civil War that broke out. Rwanda had a national anthem also. So these are really wonderful songs that are lofty and idealistic. But I want you to put that aside and come with me on a journey to view this dangerous gap that exists in America. And I think that gap can best be seen and heard in the musical cultures. This gap pushes the two Americas further apart every year and every election cycle. Are they as different though as two Germanys or two Koreas or two Rwandas? What is the nature of the divide? Is it hostile? How hostile is it? In the context of nationalism, this is a critical question. So we'll return to this question at the end of the journey through two areas of America's most definitively American musical cultures: African-American urban popular music, from the blues all the way to hip-hop, through soul, and country music. I know some of you are thinking, yes, they're very different, so what? But I want you to resist that impulse to dismiss the differences and to overlook the consequence of this seemingly simplistic difference. In Nigeria, where I'm from, you might listen to Yoruba juju music, which is a particular ethnic group and their music, and then you might listen to Igbo highlife music, and you might fleetingly conclude that they are different, forgetting that the very foundation of these differences led to a bloody civil war in the 1960s. So the music is like a prelude or an overture of a musical composition that leads to something much more significant. If we can continue on our journey, I want to start with some preliminaries. You know, every time you set up on a journey, you get your documents ready, you get your visa, your inoculations, all of that. So I want to start with some preconceived notions that I've had over a period of time teaching and researching country and soul music and hip hop. The first notion that I'd like to talk about is that I know that there are many Americas, there are lots of Americas, but I'm interested in two that are represented by listeners and artists, black and white. So the two that I'm interested in are the culturally urban city black and culturally rural country white. Those are the two Americas that I'm looking at. These two Americas began to take shape in my mind as a child growing up in West Africa many, many years ago, when we used to watch lots of American television shows without really understanding their contexts. So if you would, imagine me as a little girl in the 1970s, sitting in front of our enormous 12-inch television set. And we would, on Friday nights, we would put the television on. It was a special time. We would all get together and we would see one America. So this is what we would see. And this is what we would hear. To take form, especially when I compared it with the show that we would watch on the Saturday night. So here's what we would watch on Saturday nights. Before the Clamperts of the Beverly Hills moved to Beverly Hills, they were living in the hills of Kentucky. Things that served to form a composite of the identity of those people included a lack of education, a certain ignorance to the immediate outside world, an affinity for the great outdoors, and an unwavering pride in all of this. In their autobiographies, Dolly Parton, Loretta Lynn, Johnny Cash, reiterate these aspects of identity in their upbringings in Tennessee, Kentucky, and Arkansas, respectively. On the other hand, we've got the Evans family in Good Times, which depicts a hardworking, downtrodden, struggling community that inhabits America's concrete jungles. Where the Clamperts seemed to revel in their lack of education, the Evans struggled to ensure that, against staggering odds, the next generation achieves higher levels of education. Tupac Shakur's poem, "The Rose That Grew Out of Concrete," explains the difficulty that young people face in these environments. Jay-Z reiterates these odds in his book Decoded. Quote, "When crack landed in our hood, it was a total takeover, sudden, complete. It was an irreversible reality." So these two Americas began to emerge in my young mind, and when I would hear the country music and soul music on our local radios, I began to associate them with the life represented in these two shows. I began to realize that music was more than music. It was a language and culture and religion and so much more. The way Granny in Beverly Hillbillies shook her fist at Jethro if he tried to do anything that was modern and not what they were used to. And the way young Michael Evans would hold his fist up and talk about the black Jesus and black power. Those two symbols in my young mind at the time signified that there were two threads here, at least two threads. I later found out that I wasn't so far from my idea of music and life and these TV shows. I later found that the Beverly Hillbillies theme song was actually performed by bluegrass pioneers Earl Scruggs and Lester Flatt, while the theme song of Good Times has been sampled several times by hip-hop artists like Ghostface Killah. So the TV shows, the music continues on in those two musical cultures. So that's the first thing, to understand that I'm looking at these are the two Americas that I'm interested in, that I'm looking at. Second notion that I'd like to introduce is this notion that of what culture is. So when I teach my classes at University of Missouri, or when I was here in Chicago, we would always look at different definitions of culture, and we would always really like this the definition from Mahatma Gandhi, which says that no culture can live if it attempts to be exclusive. We like that, especially in the context of thinking about hip-hop or other kinds of African-American expressive cultures. We define these cultures as cultures that really are more inclusive than exclusive. And so if, for example, hip-hop had stayed in the Bronx, it may have died. But hip-hop is inclusive. It allows everyone around the world to key into it and use it. And it has grown and it has spread. So that's something of great pride to many of my students and to those of us who think about Black music. So it's inclusive. It's a good thing. And there's several ways of seeing how this is. If we look at Billboard's top 100 over a period of time, and so we've been looking at this for a while, I took just some years from the 70s and the 80s, and of course Billboard Hot 100 are lists of those songs each year that have crossed over to the mainstream. So this is not the R&B or hip hop list or the country list. This is just the hot songs that Americans have bought or played on their radios. And as you can see, there are many, all these is music from Black expressive culture. Only three of them on this list, 1975, and then from 80 to 83, only three of the songs are country songs, which goes to prove that black music is extremely attractive to a mainstream audience. And then if we look at, I also enjoy following the numbers. So if we look at two of the biggest selling artists on both sides, both Americas, one would be Garth Brooks, of course, superstar, and I'm looking at his six best years. He sold 36.2 million albums worldwide. So we're looking at worldwide, how this music crosses over to a worldwide audience. That's huge. It's Garth Brooks. He's the biggest one out there. Whitney Houston is maybe one of the biggest on the other side. She sold at least 10 to 13 more than Garth Brooks and worldwide. And so if we look at world audiences, Garth Brooks sold mostly in Canada and Australia. Whitney Houston sold in every continent in the world. Again, it just goes to show how attractive and inclusive Black music is. Garth Brooks is the biggest on the countryside, and yet he couldn't even sell as many as Whitney Houston. But then the problem is that notion number three, these are the notions that we're taking with us on our journey, is that we should actually, even though there is that great deal of inclusivity with Black music, there is a question mark when we come to the viability and the consistency of Black music on the charts. The fact that it's inclusive does not really mean that Black music is a viable and consistently lucrative product for the community. If you look at this slide, you'll see that over the years from the 1946 is when the Billboard Hot 100 started their lists, up till 2011, there have been lots of peaks and valleys in how blacks are represented on the top of these charts. Starting off in 1950, goes up a bit because of Motown in the 50s and 60s, and then it hits a peak and starts going down because of British invasion. So the Beatles, the Rolling Stones begin to take over the charts at that point. The Bee Gees then, and then into the 80s, we've got Wham and Duran Duran and Boy George and all these artists that take over the top of those charts. And then we get another peak in the 1980s into the 1990s with hip hop, and then another valley because of what some scholars are calling the whitening of black music. So that's a big question mark. And so I think we should pause on that and think about what is it that allows the whitening of black music such that there are these peaks and valleys for black artists. Black music is a phenomenon that is rich and wonderful, and lots of ethnomusicologists over a period of time have tried to define what the qualities are. And so there's some of my favorites are Portia Maltsby, Melanie Burnham, and Ollie Wilson, who have explained the qualities that black music shares across the diaspora. So, for example, they talk a lot about rhythmic complexity. They talk about percussive, the percussive nature of voice and instrument. They talk about call and response that you will often find in black music. They talk about dense structure, filling up of spaces. And they, of course, talk about movement and animation that you'll find in black music. And so some examples, of course, would be, I want to play an example of Hank Williams, Sr., singing Your Cheating Heart, just, you know, a good old honky-tonk song. And then I'm going to play a version where James Brown sings it, and you'll see how James Brown and his approach to that this same simple song has all these things that Ollie Wilson is talking about really quickly. This is Hank Williams, just listen to the instrumentation. Aesthetic approach to the one song from both sides of the aisle. So why does black music, I mean, what James Brown does, right, with a country song, why is it that black music keeps dipping on that chart? How is what James Brown does co-opted and whitened and made to be replicated on the charts by people who are not black? So one of my favorite examples of the whitening of black style is actually Jennifer Nettles, who's a country music singer with Sugarland, which is actually one of my, and by the way, I do love country music. I wanted to let you know that. I love black music and I love country music, which I used to try to hide, but you know, it's on my iPod, so I might as well embrace it. So I'm teaching classes on that now. But Jennifer Nettles is one of the examples that people always reach for when they want to say, look, here's a white girl who really sounds like Aretha Franklin, and she's a country singer. So here is one of the reasons for those dips on that chart I showed you. And this is the country music Christmas show. To watch because it seems so contrived. It seems so, you know, let's just watch many Aretha Franklin and Whitney Houston videos and take that and replicate it. And so that's one of the reasons why one of the points of disturbance for me is just seeing this complete takeover of black music and black style. So as I said, many people are calling this the whitening of black style. People like Brian Ward wrote about this some years ago, and he said, it's a careful whitening of black style, which is a deliberate affront to black dignity. And I think that quote is at the center of the panel that was so brilliant last night. Just, you know, the idea of the dignity of black music and black artists. Another really good quote is from Amiri Baraka, who said it is the harnessing of black energy for dollars by white folks. I mean, it's hard to hear, I know, but this is what these scholars are saying. And then this is Portia Maltby, and she's a little bit more caustic. And she says, the most widespread systematic rape and uncompensated cultural exploitation the entertainment industry has ever seen. And those are some pretty harsh words. But when you turn the television on and you watch shows like The Voice, American Idol, you see this coming true in 2012. So, for example, with American Idol, I pulled up images of the last few years of the top 10, and this is what they all look like. This is the top 10 of American Idol, and you'll see on this that there's usually one black person in the middle, right? They're always in the middle, but it's just the one person usually surrounded by the others. And I find these intriguing because it's so symbolic of this of what these scholars are saying about the takeover of black music. All right, so let's move on really quickly to our next notion. The notion is the notion that country music is actually in terms of Mahatma Gandhi's quote that no culture can live if it attempts to be exclusive, well, they're exclusive. They don't want to be on the top 100 Billboard chart, but they're still commercially strong. There's that movie that came out with Gwyneth Paltrow, I think last year. Terrible movie. Did you guys see that movie?
Yes.
Don't bother. Did you like it? Did anybody like that movie? It was tragic, but the title is so true. It's country strong commercially. If we look at Garth Brooks' sales in the United States, he sold 65 million, whereas Whitney Houston, with all her sales across the world, has only sold 32 million. So within the borders of the United States, right, of the United States of America, Garth Brooks and his music is much more commercially viable than even Whitney Houston's in the United States, which speaks to the fact that it is exclusive, but they don't care because it's still making money. No apologies. It's not flailing on its way to death, at least not here in the U.S. Country has found a way to cross over. There are many ways that they do this. They sell within their own borders of their fans, but they also find ways to, for example, create girl anthems that transcend borders, like Taylor Swift will write a song about a girl burning up a picture. I mean, all girls can understand that, right? So there are those types of lyrics that cross over. Or create a really sexy song like the one that Lady Antebellum did with Need You Now, which didn't make its way to the top of the 100 list. Or find a black friend.
Yes.
As all the artists have done with Lionel Richie lately. Have you guys seen that? I mean, they were trying to work with Lionel Richie. I mean, so badly. It's interesting. Or Tim McGraw did something with Nelly, or more recently Jason Aldean did something with Ludacris. So I'm going to show you. I think the one I'm going to show you is Jason Aldean. So Jason Aldean is a big fan. If you don't know, he's a very big star, superstar, country music. So he has brought in hip hop. And he's selling lots of records. And then he went and he found Ludacris, and they collaborated. So this part is this.
Got a whole six pack of ice, but I'm running on a hot wheel. Z back in a furry swerve.
the country artists do things like this, it brings them a whole new audience, and they just keep piling on and piling on. Now, my young African-American students in Missouri, I ask them, okay, so which country artist do you like? Jason Aldean, right? It's interesting. So commercially, very, very smart, and it's so viable that People Magazine has a special issue just for country, the country music fans, which comes out several times a year. And some of their covers, here's what their covers look like. I mean, just really, they're able to sell these things, and I haven't yet seen People Magazine do the same thing for blues music or for soul music or for any of the other kinds of music. Sorry? Okay. Okay, awesome. Amen. So good, right? So bad. So then, the next thing I want to talk about very quickly is this tendency for us to then dismiss country music. Every time I ask students, oh, you know, I'm teaching a class on Introduction to Soul and Country Music, which I teach regularly. It's a popular class, but getting students to come to those classes is sometimes a challenge, because the black kids say, okay, can it just be intro to soul music? Like, why do we have to talk about country music, right? And I used to get that a lot in Chicago. Now I'm in Missouri, the students are like, can we just do this about country music? Let's forget about soul music. It's comical. But I do find that city folk tend to dismiss country music, and I think that's a dangerous thing to do, given the strength of country music commercially, and in a minute I'm going to talk about culturally too. I always ask my students to go out and find fans, soul music fans or country music fans, and ask them five questions. One of the questions we always ask the fans is, we ask the soul music fans, okay, give me an adjective for country music. So we've been building this database of adjectives for country music. And we also ask country music fans to give us some adjectives about soul music. So it's become very interesting. We now have thousands and thousands of adjectives, but I pulled up just a few to show you how dismissive we are, I think, of country music. So we get words like, oh, it's boring, you know, it's stupid, you know, why do we listen to it, or why should we even learn about it? It's awful, it's 97% horrible, yeah, it's patriotic, it's S-H-I-T, it's for white people, it's honky-tonk, it's okay, but so what, right? And so on and so forth. We always get these words. But it, again, I would say that it's a dangerous trend for us to dismiss it, because these people are a fundamentally strong and influential part of the heartland of the United States. And so let's move on real quickly to my last thing, which connects to my caution to not dismiss it. Country music is also strong culturally, in terms of an identity. They've got their identity down, they're sticking with it, and they're not apologizing. The reason why why black urban America and the rest of us cannot dismiss this America is that, in spite of the flippant dismissal of this culture, these folks are proud of who they are and what they represent. According to country music historian Bill Malone, quote, the defense of slavery and the racial hierarchy lay at the core of the South's belief system, a system militantly dedicated to the preservation of the status quo. Southerners adhered to that which was familiar and comfortable, and to the maintenance of these traditions. That's the fan base of country music, according to a country music historian who is well respected in any ethnomusicological or musicological circle. So just as black pride is strong, white country folks are not only commercially strong, but extremely secure and unrelenting in their sense of identity. And so I want to play you a quick example of the same Jason Aldean singing that same song without Ludacris, like at a country music event, festival. where he gets to forget about ludicrous and black folk and just focus on his constituency. So here is, it's a really rough recording. And here he's singing with Cold Ford, who is a country music star also. I want you to look at the imagery on the stage. Same song and recreate it for their own audience that love it, just love it. So I thought it was so interesting. So remember, the initial question was, what is the nature of the divide between these two Americas? Is it just a little footpath or a gaping chasm? Let's look at two significant areas. Let's look at identity and politics, and then we'll wrap it up. So very quickly. In terms of identity, I like to use this map as a way of showing what the scholars say are the country music states in red and the soul music states in blue. Besides Louisiana, which does have a blue star, all those southern states are red states. And of course, they use red and blue for obvious reasons, I think. While the urban and rural division is a clear way of seeing the gap between our two Americas, the Mason-Dixon line gives us a physical border, an enduring historical line of demarcation, almost in the tradition of the Great Wall of China or the Berlin Wall. Yet, tracing the Americas to their roots, we find that both black music and country music had their beginnings below that line. So it's interesting that they're both rooted in the same place, which of course makes our current situation that much more disturbing. So just going back in terms of identity to the roots, we have all these great names that come from below that Mason-Dixon line: Jelly Roll, Martin, Bessie Smith, Ma Rainey, Jimmy Rogers, Robert Johnson, Bill Monroe, who was a great bluegrass singer, instrumentalist, Muddy Waters, Pete Seeger is the only one on that list of the Americana greats that's from above that line, but everybody else from below that line. And then of course the two big ones would be Huddy Leadbelly and Woody Guthrie, which really signify the strength of the roots, right, of the music that I'm talking about now as having gone on two different paths. So let's listen very quickly to Leadbelly, National Defense Blues.
Yo, just because she was waking.
The roots of the music, we think about the 1930s, we think about the Great Depression, unemployment, displaced workers, and then of course we think of blues and bluegrass, and this is where we situate the music of Lead Belly. I mean, it's all about a really tough working environment. He's talking about the economy there. You know, it's a personal story, but it's still about what's going on at that time. It's talking about relationships, and it's a simple sound. You know, it's just a man and his guitar. The other example, of course, we can't do without is Woody Guthrie, Oklahoma native, and Woody Guthrie did one that I like, which is called "Hard Traveling." Again, it's signifies that, you know, they're not as far apart in their roots.
I've been having some hard traveling, I thought you knowed. I've been having some hard traveling way down the road. I've been having some hard traveling, hard rambling, hard gambling. I've been having some hard traveling, Lord. I've been riding in fast travelers, I thought you knowed. I've been riding in flat wheelers way down the road. I've been riding in blind passengers, dead enders, picking up cinders. I've been hitting some hard traveling, Lord. I've been hitting some hard rock mining, I thought you knowed. I've been leaning on a pressure drill way down the road. Iron flying, arrow sucking, 6 foot of mud and a short bit of mud. I've been having some hard traveling, Lord.
And so, ethnomusicologists like Alan Lomax recognized that Woody Guthrie and Lead Belly should be spoken of almost in the same breath. Mm. But when we then stretch that trajectory out and come to where we are now, we've got two different branches. It's almost like the roots have spurted a trunk, and that trunk two branches, and those two branches have broken off and fallen on two separate sides. So here's a quick image of a Kenny Chesney concert. All the hands up in the arena are white. I considered going once, but I don't know, I just wasn't too comfortable with it. And here's an image of a Brian McKnight concert, in which we have a whole different world of individuals. And so when we think about how these people are identified, these branches they reaffirm the representative identities on both sides. So for country, we have this idea, and my students keep bringing these words in, of hillbillies, right? And country artists either they stick to those images. Their albums have the idea of Southern pride, of even their names are representative of that Southern pride, that patriotic fervor that these artists have as hillbillies. They use names like Lady Antebellum, right? Dixie Chicks, Alabama, Sugarland, Lone Star, the Civil Wars, the Confederate Railroad. I mean, these are names that signify a sense of identity that they're very proud of. When asked, or when we look at lyrics and you ask, okay, what does a hillbilly really mean? They come up with these types of lyrics. From Big and Rich, hillbillies love it in the hay. So that means it's some kind of farm situation, right? It's rural. Blake Shelton, I'm sorry about the typo there, but Blake Shelton, in his song Hillbilly Bone, sings, and when the band starts banging and the fiddle saws, you can't help but hollering yee-haw. That's hillbilly. And then the artists who call themselves poverty hillbillies, or poverty neck hillbillies, sing, Saturday night I truck into town, so there's a truck involved. They raise a little hell, they close the honky-tonk down. It's not a blues club, it's a honky-tonk. You might not like what you see, that really doesn't matter to me. Again, no apologies, because I'm going to do it the hillbilly way. That's where I was born, it's how I was raised. If you don't like what I'm doing, what can I say? Hey, the only way I know how to do is the hillbilly way. You know, so just really strong sense of who they are. So let's hear a quick song on this, and I pulled in Gretchen Wilson, of course. You guys know this song. Although you may not be able to say yeehaw with her, because she says it's a certain kind of woman that should do that. Okay, so let's listen in. The feel of that music, it comes from those roots that Woody Guthrie and Lead Belly represented in our previous example. Here she's talking about honky tonks, she's talking about not wanting the sweet champagne, she wants beer. She is talking about the baby on her hip, she ain't no high class broad, she shops at Walmart. You know, which is a significant thing. You may think that she's trashy, but she doesn't give a rip, right? And so she calls on all her sisters to do the same and say hell yeah. Okay, so then on the other side, we've got another part of another side of the branches, where we've got hillbillies on the one side, we've got homies on the other side. And of course, I'm talking about a contemporary version of the identity on the black music side. So in terms of maybe more hip-hop, the image is a lot more confrontational, maybe that there's militance there's an assertiveness that's almost aggressive, understandably. Their names connote a sense of self-empowerment and militance. Names like Mos Def, names like Machiavelli, Wu-Tang Clan, Gangstar, Big Punisher, The Cool, Outcast. I mean, all these are names that are nothing like the other side, right? These are names that really represent a different kind of reality, a different kind of experience. When we look for lyrics on what the homie means, and of course there's another word I could have used, but you know, homie is okay, we can use that. Things like little homies on the right, niggas, I'm sorry, that's the word. niggas got, okay, good, thank you, Miss Lewis. Yeah. Niggas gonna die tonight, let's get hype tonight. Let little homies on the mash running from these punk police, because little niggas run the streets, right? So it's a different, completely a different sense of reality. Let's go to R. Kelly. He says, it's almost a dirge. You are my homie, my stony, my roomie, my nigga. Never placed no bitch before me. Man, I swear to God, I love you for that shit. Why do you have to get hit? So we've got the police, we've got guns, we've got violence, we've got gangs. It's a different state of being. So let's again, you know, we had Gretchen Wilson on the one hand. On this other side of identity, in terms of a musical example, the one I always love is this young man called Donnie, who is not that popular because he's just so he's so organic and just he really brings it, and you will never find him on the Billboard charts. But he has this song called "Welcome to the Colored Section," which I adore this song. So I thought it would be a good way of exemplifying the sense of identity. The blue states and the red states, obviously. And this is a quick snapshot of how America voted in 2004. Again, where the country music states are right where the red states are politically. And that's why I think it's an important thing to think about. When we ask our fans, when my students go out and ask fans, okay, what is important to you? On both sides, they all the fans say, you know, we want to talk about wealth, we want to talk about the economy, abortion is a big issue that needs to be looked at, church and state, gun control, all these are big issues for the fans of soul and country music. Now, depending on how you define these values, you may or may not be considered a real American by the other American, right? So I thought it'd be interesting to look at the case of the spokespeople, like when we talk about politics and how to deal with presidential races and so on, because we're coming to one right now. I wanted to reference the case of Kanye West. So you remember that, right? Vaguely.
The black people, the less well off to help the poor, the black people, the less well off as slow as possible. I mean, this is, Red Cross is doing everything they can. We already realized a lot of the people that could help are at war right now, fighting another way, and they've given them permission to go down and shoot us.
So the best part of this is the face that Michael Myers has. It was hilarious, but I think I missed the part where Kanye West says that Bush doesn't care about black people, and that's the issue. Now Kanye West, of course, a huge star on the black music side, and I like to look at the comments on YouTube. I just spend time on the comments. The comments are so interesting. Yeah, they're not scholars. They're not here right now. But that's America. So some of the comments were things like, go Kanye, amen. George Bush didn't care about poor people. He doesn't care about us. Just so happened that these poor people were 98% black. Another one says George Bush and his cronies don't care about black people any more than they seem to care about anyone else. And then this one, Bush is a retarded snow monkey. Literally, he's a chronic idiot. I don't know what a snow monkey is, so somebody can explain that to me. It's a beautiful animal. Okay, so Bush is a beautiful man, a beautiful animal. Okay, then another example on the other side is the case of Hank Williams. I don't know if you remember that. So Hank Williams went on national television, and Hank Williams Jr. is a huge star in country music. He's adored. And he went on there and said Obama was Hitler, right? And there was a lot of brouhaha about that. A lot of people said, you know, he should be reprimanded for that. And in fact, his song was taken off the Monday night NFL game.
Yep.
But then the following week, he went on the CMT Awards and was celebrated. So here is what I'm talking about. I'll just fast forward. This is Brad Paisley and Carrie Underwood.
Compare the president to Hitler.
The applause goes on and on and on when they're reminded that this man actually compared the president of the United States to Hitler. So I mean, that's why we can't dismiss them. You know, this is they're a very important part of the culture. So the comments on this on YouTube, we love Hank Jr. And this is in caps. This is not my caps. This is their caps. Obama is Hitler. Fuck Obama. He fucking America. Oh, he fucking America. Obama, sorry. This piece of dog shit never had a real job in his life. Get this POS. You know what POS is? Okay. Out of here. So let me get this straight. Because the South is the Bible Belt, and most of the South is Christian. And a lot love the rebel flag that we just saw in that other video. You call us stupid. Wow, I believe you are the dumb. Anyway, you get the point. And so on and so forth. And then recently, in 2004, this is how the rural vote went in the West. Rural vote was very, very high, and in the South. So as we are in an election year, I just thought it would be good for us to pay attention to that. On CNN, some of the polls right now show that in, for example, Louisiana, 95% of the voters are white. I believe they're the people who you would see clapping for a Hank Williams, possibly. And in terms of religiousness, I thought that this was interesting. People who considered themselves very religious would give Romney the vote over Obama, and of course that's something that people are talking about a lot now. So, and this is the heart of country music. In terms of 9/11 responses, I think that's another great way of thinking about politics and music. Jadakiss had this really great song called "What If." What if Malcolm was silent? What if Martin was silent? I flow calm, but don't push. What if Saddam hung Bush? What if Obama was on Mount Rushmore? I mean, these are really, really thoughtful questions. You know, they would be considered unpatriotic. On the other hand, because Brad Paisley sings, well, if there's anyone that still has pride in the memory of those that died, defending the red, white, and blue, this is country music, and we do. Completely different approach to events like 9/11. Don't know if you've heard the Toby Keith song, but that's another great way of seeing the differences. I'm running out of time, so I'm just gonna rush through these last ones. And so Toby Keith is very, he's very strong about, you know, going over and kicking the asses. I mean, he uses words like that of the Middle East. And on the other hand, we've got a guy like the Martel Technique, who is Afro-Peruvian, who collaborates with Mos Def, Jadakiss, and Eminem to talk about why that happened, why 9/11 happened, and to ask the questions about foreign policy over a period of time. So while one, on the one hand, proclaims unwavering pride, the other asks questions. And I think that this is one of the ways of signifying how different these two Americas are. So I'm going to conclude by, just going to rush over this. To return to the initial question, having considered the obvious and obscure notions pertaining to the music, having assessed the profiles of the two Americas in terms of their identity and their politics, what is the nature of the divide? How should we characterize it? To quote the irreplaceable Luther Vandross, a house is not a home when there's no one there, right? So likewise, music is noisy and empty unless we stop to consider the people therein. The artists, the fans, their politics, their values, and their culture. In the case of black pop music and country music, we must pay attention. Because of the inclusivity of black music, the majority of the black music on our airwaves has either been sanitized or desensitized or over-sexualized. For example, if you look right now, if you go to the Billboard page, the top of the R&B hip hop charts now are songs like "Birthday Cake" by Rihanna and Chris Brown, "The Motto" by Drake and Lil Wayne, and "Drank My Cup" by Kirko Banks. And I challenge you to go and just listen to those lyrics and see what they're talking about. These are the top of the R&B and hip hop charts. In contrast, the top of the country charts features the same old Jason Aldean singing a song called "Flyover States," where he romanticizes Tennessee and all and wonderful southern states. Kip Moore has a song called "Something About a Truck," of course, and Rascal Flatts has a song called "Banjo." You know, very different. In 2012, One America seems to be holding tight to pride in their identity and values, in spite of Clear Channel and Viacom, while the other seems to have let go of theirs because of Clear Channel and Viacom and other forces. The rippling effect of this can be found across the Atlantic. And if you guys have like just a few minutes, I just want to show you a 30-second clip of a Nigerian artist who is an R&B singer, and he's R&B because he's influenced by what he sees on the top of the Billboard R&B charts. And this is what he's put out, and this is the hot one in Nigeria right now. And it signifies the disturbing trend that's happening in black music across the world. This afternoon, which was if we could get people like the divas, the Chicago blues divas, to come to Africa and explain through their art the roots of the music, the pride in the music, maybe they wouldn't do this, right? This is not what what they should be doing, but this is what they're doing because this is what they have access to. So at symposia and conferences like this, I know that I'm preaching to the choir. I could see nods, and everybody was with me on all of this, I think. But we leave with, we don't have the young people who are buying this in our audience now. But we do leave with higher hopes and deeper motivations to teach, write, compose, and activate our students, our readers, our audiences, to pay attention and attempt change. So, you know, just a big thanks to Janice for doing this, to Dominican for hosting all of us here, and for all of the great and wonderful panels I've already seen this morning. Zandria was fantastic. And I know that we are in for a treat in a few minutes, and I'm so glad that Janice put me before Mark Anthony Neal and not after him, because I can't go after him. So, you know,
can
just...
Can take some time for questions, because we're going to start Mark Anthony Neal at 5:30.
Okay,
so
okay.
Let's take about maybe 10 minutes max.
Okay, so I just want you to think about the questions that you would ask. In 2012, this little West African girl looks back to those childhood memories. Granny is still shaking her fist at any modern encroachment on her southern roots and tradition, but Michael Evans and his Black Power Fist are long gone. Thank you.